Hi guys, welcome back to the Political Reading Corner, where we talk about the politics of American literature. Today, we're going to discuss how Mitsuye Yamada's Camp Notes and Other Poems uses motherhood values to demonstrate the evils of Japanese internment camps and change the narrative put forward by the U.S. government that the internment camps were beneficial, safe, and non-threatening. So, let's get into it. Mitsuye Yamada was born in Japan and raised in Seattle. However, when World War II started, her family was relocated to an internment camp in Idaho. Her book, Camp Notes and Other Poems, is a collection of poetry that you can see here that she wrote during and after her experience in internment. The collection clearly demonstrates the harms that internment had, both on individuals and on society. One way that Yamada demonstrates these harms is through motherhood values. Her poem, The Night Before Goodbye, is centered around motherhood and trauma. It's short, and I'm going to read it to you. The Night Before Goodbye. Mama is mending my underwear while my brothers sleep. Her husband taken away by the FBI. One son lured away by the army. Now another son and daughter lusting for the free world outside. She must let go. The war goes on. She will take one still small son and join Papa in internment to make a family. Still sewing, squinting in the dim light in room C, barrack 4, block 4, she whispers, "Remember, keep your underwear in good repair. In case of accident, don't bring shame on us." There's a lot that happens in this piece, so we're going to chunk it up. The poem begins with, "Mama is mending my underwear while my brothers sleep." At first, this seems like it may be occurring in a normal domestic space, with a mother fulfilling her domestic duties while surrounded by her family that she cares for. However, the next lines say, her husband taken away by the FBI, one son lured away by the army. This demonstrates that the anti-Japanese sentiments in the US are tearing her family apart. The forces that are bigger than her, like the FBI and the army, provide her with no power to serve her family in the domestic space in accordance with traditional motherhood values because they are physically being taken away and spread apart. The second line, one son lured away by the army, is especially important considering the history of the internment camps. At the same time that Japanese Americans were being stripped of their rights and forced into internment camps, the U.S. Army was drafting Japanese American men from the internment camps to fight on the behalf of the U.S. Army. So when the poem speaker says one son was lured away by the army, that means that the speaker's own brother was fighting on the behalf of the country that was imprisoning his mother and siblings. The poem continues, now another son and daughter lusting for the free world outside. She must let go. The war goes on. She will take one still small son and join Papa in internment to make a family. This section demonstrates how the mother does not have the power to maintain her domestic space and care for her family in the traditional way, but she still tries to make a family within the internment camp in order to fulfill her motherhood duty. This is important because it demonstrates that Japanese American mothers want to fulfill the traditional motherhood duty established by white American women. This contrasts the prevalent narrative at the time that Japanese Americans are enemies of the state and they threaten the security of the nation. Instead, Yamada is portraying this mother who desires domesticity, and she is being threatened by the US government. In this way, Yamada is flipping the enemy script. The US Army is threatening the security and safety of American families, including Japanese Americans, who are not enemies of the state, but are just trying to be a family. The final lines demonstrate this threat that the internment camps pose to families and the inability of mothers to protect their family in this foreign, non-domestic domain. Yamada writes, still sewing, squinting in the dim light in room C, barrack 4, block 4, she whispers, remember, keep your underwear in good repair. In case of accident, don't bring shame on us. Here, the mother is still trying to maintain her role as a mother and perform her duties, such as sewing, but she's acknowledging her relative inability to actually secure her family's well-being. She acknowledges the possibility of sexual assault against her daughter, but can't prevent it. Instead, she tells her daughter to protect the family by not bringing shame on them should sexual assault occur. This is quite shocking to contemporary readers, but it emphasizes the powerlessness of a mother in that situation. She can't protect her family's well-being the way she could if they were not in internment camps. Throughout, the mother tries to continue to preserve a domestic space and the well-being of her family, but the internment camp makes it impossible to do so. This highlights how the internment camps are detrimental to individuals and society, as families were unable to exist in the traditional ways or spaces. In this way, Yamada uses motherhood to advance her political agenda. She is rewriting the history of internment camps, which the US government had previously portrayed as beneficial and non-harmful. Scholar Anita Patterson documents how the US government would go to places where Japanese Americans were boarding buses that would take them to internment camps, and the photographer would cheerfully tell the people to smile and then would snap a picture. And those seemingly harmless pictures were then used as propaganda to convince the American people that Japanese Americans weren't upset to be forced into internment camps because, look, there's picture evidence of them smiling. Fortunately, there are those like Yamada who work to tell the truth of this historical moment. Scholar Kristine Kuramitsu documents how internees in the internment camps used art to both preserve Japanese culture and to depict the truth of the internment experience. Kuramitsu describes how these art pieces are used to both communicate the ideas of the artist and to help the artist realize their conceptions of the experience, both in its relation to the shared experience with other Japanese Americans and in its relation to the pain instituted by the US government. Kuramitsu argues that in this reflection of experience, internment art reclaims and physically remakes history. By telling the story of her own painful experiences through her art, her poetry, Yamada is rewriting the narrative of internment camps from these happy, beneficial spaces to ones of pain, trauma, and damaged families. Yamada's whole collection is really good, and it all focuses on the Japanese internment camps. There are also other poems about motherhood that really reflect the experience of motherhood in internment camps and the family experience as a whole. I highly recommend the collection. I'm not that into poetry usually, but these poems are really easy to understand, both like on a surface level as well as in being analyzed for deeper meaning. The way that they're ordered in camp notes and other poems really makes them tell a broader story than just each poem alone does. And it also touches on racism beyond the internment camps, the experience of living beyond the internment camps and still experiencing systematic racism. Additionally, her collection is published by Kitchen Table Women of Color Press, which works to disseminate and promote women of color authors. So you should definitely check them out too if you're interested. That's all I have for you today. As always, the resources will be linked down below, as well as a transcript of this video with inline citations for all of the info I've presented. Be sure to like, comment, and subscribe, and check out my other videos. Spread peace, friends.